My name is Morgan McTavish, and I'm very excited to be your moderator for our first session this morning. We have a great lineup here today, and we're excited to start it off this morning with the Profitability of Food-Grade Soybeans, sponsored by Nufarm. So just to start, I'm going to introduce to you our three great speakers we have for you this morning. So we have Sandy Hart, Seed Business Manager with Sevita. We have Matt Renkema, Export Market Manager with Sevita. And we also have Patrick Butters, a local grower. So just a quick note before we get started, we want to make this as engaging and interactive as possible. So we do have a chat box that is going to be live throughout the presentation. Definitely recommend that you send us your name and let us know where you're tuning in from this morning. And of course, if you have any questions at all throughout the presentation, please send them in the chat and we will get to them at the end of the presentation. So I guess we'll start it here and I'll pass it over to you, Sandy.
Perfect. Thanks, Morgan. Excited to be here this morning. So this morning, we're going to talk a little bit about the profit potential of food-grade IP soybeans relative to commodity GM beans. And we're also going to explore a little bit the importance of that IP market to Canadian producers and the importance of Canadian producers to that IP market. So we're going to go about that effectively by having myself moderate a bit of a discussion between both ends of the value chain. So we've got the buyers and end users here represented by Matt Renkema, who's the grain business manager for Sevita, and the producer perspective of Patrick Butters of Butter Farms in St. Thomas, Ontario. So we'll talk about what's important to each, why Canada is a great fit to supply this high value market, and hopefully generate some questions from the crowd as well. So Matt, I think let's get started with the customer, and in this case, of course, we mean the end use customer. So you've marketed Canadian soybeans all over the world. What can you tell us about what the buyers are looking for? What's important to them?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it certainly differs from one market to the next, but I'd say there's really three key criteria for buyers in the food grade soybean market. The first one would be quality product. Quality product both in terms of appearance, packaging, the quality of the soybeans, along with the quality of the varieties that we develop. The second thing would be a fair price. They want a cost-effective solution for whatever product they're making. Whether it be a product that needs high protein or lower protein, they want a cost-effective and fair price for that product. Finally, they are looking for long-term supply partnerships. They don't want to have one supplier this year and a different supplier the next. They want to be sure of their supply of high quality product every year.
Great. So we know soybeans are grown basically all over the world. If you take the perspective of the Canadian export industry as a whole, how are we doing delivering on those factors? What would you share there?
Yeah, I think Canada's definitely still the leader when it comes to high quality food grade soybeans. And I'd say there's really four reasons for that. Number one is we have a world recognized identity preservation system. It's the only one like it in the world. It's called CIPRIS. This program is audited by third parties, and it really tracks the production of the food soybeans and other products right from the planted seed all the way to the delivery to the export / end use customer. Yeah, so that's really important. The second thing is we do provide superior quality compared to other origins, both in terms of size, protein, along with the investment into the cleaning equipment that we use. Third, we have a robust public and private breeding programs throughout Canada, such as Sevita Genetics, that develops varieties for defined attributes, whether it be sugar content, protein content, isoflavones, or really whatever the end user is looking for. Finally, and probably most importantly, we have a great group of committed growers that are committed to producing high quality crop. They partner with us, the exporter, to ensure that they're meeting what the customer on the end use side really wants.
So maybe just to follow up on that, Matt, from a practical perspective, and again, considering that the Canadian industry as a whole, you know, there's give or take 90 countries each and every year that are going to produce a crop of soybeans. And a lot of them are a lot closer to the markets that you service in Asia. So what are the, what are the key factors, I suppose, in that demand for Canadian beans, and where is it headed? Where has it been heading? Could you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, for sure. I think I'm just popping up a slide here right now. I'll get to it in a second. So the global demand for food grade soybeans will continue to grow. The challenge is going to be the competition from places such as the United States and then more newer exporting markets that like Eastern Europe and South America. So firstly, on the US, currently only around 4% of soybeans in the US are non-GMO. That number is closer to 20 to 25% in Eastern Canada, just for comparison. So if the US, who is typically cheaper producing non-GMO than Canada, increases their percentage of non-GMO, even just slightly, we could see a considerable market shift to the US. So if you look at this slide here that I put up, it's showing the Japan food soybean supply by origin from 2011 to 2020. As you can see, Canada exported roughly 330,000 metric tons of food grade soybeans to Japan this past year. But you can really see a gradual shift in market share percentage from Canada to the US in the past 10 years. And that's mostly due to price competitiveness and supply. Further, places such as Eastern Europe and South America, they need to continue to make progress when it comes to food safety initiatives. Currently, they don't have the reputation or the infrastructure required to compete in the premium markets where Sevita works. But if they are able to develop that and be seen as a reliable source for food-grade soybeans, we could certainly see further pressure on market share for Canadian food-grade soybeans. So I really think, you know, Canadian exporters, producers, everyone in the value chain needs to work together to protect the premium market. It is important to growers in Ontario, Quebec, and other places in Canada. So it really makes it very important that things such as the private and public breeding programs, such as Sevita Genetics, continue to work on developing varieties that perform for both the grower and the end user.
Yeah, and I'm glad you mentioned that, because it honestly is difficult to overstate the importance of continued investment in genetics. Like, talk a lot about quality from the producer perspective, be that protein or other desirable traits, and of the things that are within our control. Obviously, we can't control the weather, we can't control our growing environment from year to year. But through genetics, we can work to develop better varieties to deliver those types of attributes to end users who see fit to pay a premium for them. And it's also even more important, because that's the key to moving the needle on performance in terms of yield and disease resistance for the farmers. And it's a common misconception that all non-GM varieties are old, and that's really, really not true. Especially if you look at Canada versus the United States, like what we invest in plant breeding and genetics for non-GM for our 5 billion acres of soybean production in a given year is many times that of what is going on south of the border for their 80 to 85 give or take million acres of soybeans each and every year. So I think that is something that we do very well, that isn't always that obvious from the producer perspective, because it happens behind the scenes. So I appreciate that, Matt, for sure. I think that's maybe a good opportunity to transition and get a bit of input from Patrick here from the producer perspective. So Patrick, you've got your Ontario soybean grower hat on here. As a producer, what is important to you from Matt's commentary there?
Yeah, no, Matt said a lot of real important things that kind of hit home with me as an IP producer. One thing obviously is hearing that Canada is front and center in that market currently in the world. You want to be that one that everybody thinks of when they go, okay, you know, we're ready to make that switch. We want to start sourcing non-GM beans. It's nice to hear that Canada is right there as one of the first countries that they think of. Nothing worse than growing a product and not knowing where your market is for it. And then obviously hearing about the amount of research and stuff that's going on in the background is also really important to me as a producer, because we want to know that what we're growing is, you know, state-of-the-art tech, and that they're trying to push it along so that we can be profitable on our end. Name of the game, I guess, at the end of it all is to keep making money. So to know that money's being spent in the background, which ends up helping us as a producer grow a better soybean is real key to me.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of stuff to feel good about there, but at the end of the day, as farmers, you guys are making decisions based on maximizing profitability in a sustainable manner on the farm. So on that note, one of the things I love about you guys and your operation is the range of crops that you guys are into, and along the spectrum of effort intensiveness all the way up to some decorative pumpkins and gourds through to the more commodity grain type crops. Could you maybe touch on that a little bit for the benefit of the audience here? What goes on at Butters Farms?
Yeah, sure. We definitely, I would say, are a fairly diverse cropping farm. We do your normal like field corn, soybeans, wheat, get into some vegetables with butternut squash and sweet corn. But then our big niche market that we're into here that really kind of sets us apart from the other guys in our area are pumpkins, gourds, and ornamental corn. So strictly for the Halloween and Thanksgiving decorative season. So that's where we really focus our time there in the fall harvest wise. It's fun. It's different. I enjoy the challenge every year.
Cool. So with all that going on, I'm sure you don't have to worry about getting bored. What is it that has made the non-GM beans a fit for you guys for, I think we're talking 10 plus years now, right?
Yeah, no, we've been growing them for a long time. You know, originally started in with just a field, kind of getting your feet wet. Yeah. Like you said, 10 years ago. And then have in the last several years been virtually all IP beans. For us, making the complete switch over has just been a really good fit as far as management goes. It's been a nice fit for us from the point that we can see that added value with the premium for the extra effort that it's taking us. For us, a lot of people get hung up on the difference in the cost of chemical between a GM program and a non-GM program. I don't see that personally after growing both for so many years. We invest heavily in a pre-program every year, whether it's a GM field or a non-GM field. So I kind of chalk that up as the same dollars. The real big difference for me is when it gets into, if you're in a respray situation, and depending on what you do for a pre, there are dollars out there to actually mitigate some of the cost of that respray. But you might just be in doing an extra pass because you can't double up into a fungicide at the same time as you're doing your respray just because you can't hit it when the flowers are out. Sure. So that's about the biggest difference for me in crop, in season that way. I look at the added value of the premium as compensating me at harvest. That's where I see my biggest differences between them. The patience that's required because, you know, the outside of the bean is as important as the qualities that are in it. You know, it's got to stay clean and shiny. You can't dirt tag them or anything. So your harvest window tightens up a bit. But that's really where I see the difference is there. And that's, you know, we've been real happy with the added value and what we've seen on our bottom line at the end of it all.
Sure. So you talk a little bit about cost and then best practices that these production programs reward through the premium. I think the final piece and arguably the most important piece to that profitability equation is yield. So yourself as Butters Farms, what are your expectations? I know you do have GM and non-GM beans on the farm in any given year. What are you expecting from one system versus the other?
Yeah, we actually kind of push our beans the same. It doesn't matter what variety we're growing. You know, we're not accepting a yield lag as a reason to get a premium in the IP fields. We're pushing them and getting the same yields out of them as we do our conventional fields when we have them in. We're not accepting a yield lag there. We're pushing them all the exact same. So,
Great. No, I appreciate the perspective, Patrick. That makes a lot of sense. And it's good to know you've had that much year over year success with the system for sure. So what I've got next is just a quick slide that that illustrates some of what Patrick's talking about in terms of yield investment and ultimately the bottom line at a few different scenarios in terms of production per acre. So I'm going to get that started here now.
So this is a chart that we like to use to demonstrate the potential of food grade IP soybeans relative to commodity GM beans from an economic perspective. So what I'm not trying to do is say IP beans will do this or GM beans will do that, because the world we live in just really isn't all that simple. What we're really trying to do here is just paint a picture of relative profit potential versus risk of each system when it comes to different levels of yield. So it's important that I quickly draw your attention to the assumptions that are driving some of the numbers on this slide. You can see them up there in the top right-hand corner. So I'm using a cash price for 21 crop soybeans in Western Ontario of $14.50 a bushel. Food grade soybean premium, $3.25 a bushel. That's fairly common and has been for the last number of years for some of the more popular varieties on the market in Ontario. I'm also going to assume a herbicide cost differential of $40 per acre. And what I mean by that is I'm assuming that we are going to spend $40 an acre on chemical, on weed control, over and above that same cost for our GM soybeans. So that's a number that can vary significantly from farm to farm, from year to year, or even from field to field within the same operation. Typically at Sevita, when we're working through this type of an exercise with producers, we're talking in that $25 to $30 all the way up to $50 to $55 range. So I do think that for the purposes of this exercise, that $40 is well supported. So you can see on the chart here, I've got my GM revenue per acre in blue, and my green line, of course, is my food grade revenue per acre that takes into account the premium and also the fact that we're gonna invest that extra $40 to keep our weeds under control, help realize those profitable yields, and maintain good quality come harvest time. So let's have a look. 60 bushel GM beans at a cash price of $14.50 is going to gross $870 per acre in revenue. If I compare that to the equivalent yield in non-GM using the assumptions that we just went through, that same number is $1,025 at 60 bushel for IP food grade beans, after you take into account, of course, that premium and the $40 an acre that we're going to spend on extra on weed control. So that's a difference of $155 per acre. Obviously, if you're able to push your food grade IP yields past that which you would expect from your GM beans, that number is going to get larger, and you're probably going to be quite happy about it. So this is what I consider the potential from an economic perspective. Now, it's important that when we're making these decisions, we look back at the other side of this, which is, of course, how much would I need to give up in terms of yield before I'm actually making less money in spite of that premium? The answer in this case, using the assumptions I went through, is just over 8.5 bushel. So the IP number at 51.3 bushels per acre, after we account for the premium and our extra investment in herbicide, that gets us to that same $870 figure. Which is what we established from the 60 bushel GM beans. So that's just over that 8.5 bushel per acre mark. And I want to say that I don't mean that as an expectation. And I do understand that break even isn't good enough. But especially if you're looking at trying something new or different, it's really, really important to know what kind of a cushion you have to work with. And I find working with farmers that the most meaningful way to express that or to calculate that is in terms of yield. So at the end of the day, the most important thing is that you're making decisions for your farm based on well-supported expectations in terms of yield and incremental costs, which may or may not be limited to just the $40 an acre that we used for this exercise on herbicide. I would also add it's not my agenda or Sevita's agenda to have every grower in Ontario planting wall-to-wall IP beans. We do invest heavily in our GM breeding and distribution business. What this is about for us is we really want to be transparent and help growers make a great decision when it comes to the soybean acres on their farm. That being said, I do think it is clear that there's significant additional income potential with food grade IP beans at profitable yields and a reasonable amount of effort and investment to make sure that mainly we keep those weeds under control and preserve good crop quality to make sure we get that premium at harvest time.
Yeah, so that's, I think, the extent of the content that we had prepared for today there, Morgan. So if there's any questions, I think we've got just a couple minutes left. We'd be happy to take those.
All right. Thank you, Sandy. And thank you, everyone, for tuning into this great discussion, guys. So thank you very much for your time and for sharing that information. We do have a question that came in from Hillary. So Hillary asks, do you find the markets for food grade beans more stable long term?
I can take this one, Sandy. So yeah, it really depends on the market we're going to. For example, Japan is a very stable market with stable demand, and we see other markets such as China and other places growing. Something that we've seen and we'll continue to see in other markets is an example that we saw in Taiwan in 2014 or 2015. Where labeling requirements forced end users to label whether or not they use GM or non-GM in their products. And we saw extreme increase in purchases of non-GMO soybeans at that time. So we do believe that this market's very stable. It's a staple in the diet of many of these Asian countries that we export to. And we see it growing here in North America as plant-based protein continues to grow.
All right. Thank you. Just a reminder to everyone tuning in. If you haven't yet, please feel free to submit your question in the chat box. We do have a few minutes left. I did have a question actually come through ahead of time from a viewer that wasn't able to send one in. So they asked, how has the COVID-19 pandemic impacted the food grade market?
I'll take this one too, I guess. I guess it really depends on what perspective you're looking at it from. So from the perspective of us as an exporter, we have seen the greatest impact when it comes to increased challenges in ocean freight. That has been a real challenge for everyone shipping anything, especially agriculture products from North America to Asia. From the perspective of the end user, it's generally fairly stable, but it can really depend on which end user you're talking about and what kind of product they're making. So for example, products that are typically consumed outside of the home would have felt the effects of COVID-19. So for example, those tofu makers, maybe that supply to restaurants where restaurants were not open as much, would have seen a decrease in demand. But in totality, I think that the demand was fairly stable. From a producer's perspective, I don't think that the effects of that demand will really have been felt by a producer, as exporters have been able to shift a lot of that supply to other markets with some recently strong demand.
Excellent, thank you. Another question just came in from Rob. Do we need inspections for food grade beans?
I can take that one. So each exporter will have their own quality protocols that fit within the CIPRS system that Matt mentioned. So speaking from a Sevita perspective, our requirement is that every first time grower gets a field walk at least 2 points throughout the growing season, and every producer gets a field walk at least once every 3 years, regardless of how long they've been working with us. And then there's a strong customer service element to it beyond that. Us and others in the industries are going to want to get out and make sure the producers are well supported and being able to deliver a quality pure crop. That said, there's no formal inspection requirement like there is with seed production or other specialty crop kinds.
I can comment too there on that. From the, as a producer, there's a little additional paperwork but a lot of it is stuff that everybody's already keeping track of, whether you have it written down on a piece of paper or not. So from that side of it, it's not a scary thing to get into. It just, you're letting them or documenting when you cleaned your planter, the chemicals you used, which all of us know already, harvest dates. Again, we all know that, and where our field locations are that the different varieties are planted. And for me, it's actually nice to have it all written out and documented to draw back on when you're trying to think of what you had in a field 2 or 3 years ago. It's all there, and you go, oh yeah, I had this variety here and that. So it actually helps your best practices a little bit from that respect too.
Excellent. One more question to close it up here. The other question is, how can we as Canada compete with the US if they increase production?
I can start with that one quick if you want, Matt. I think we touched on a lot of that. There's not such a thing, at least that I can fathom, of a silver bullet solution to compete with a market that's going to deliver a significant quantity at a good price and is getting better and better at keeping good quality and understanding the regions where they can produce good protein. What we need is a series of lead bullets, so to speak. We need to continue to invest in better genetics, both for the producers and for the end users. For the end users, that's how we generate exciting value associated with Canadian beans. For producers, that's how we generate higher yielding products and keep our costs competitive with exporters coming out of the United States. And to continue to, again, I'll use the word invest in modern processing and shipping infrastructure, so that not only can we continue to live up to the high quality standards set by ourselves and our buyers, but so that they can feel good purchasing products for food out of Canadian facilities. Those would be a couple big ones for me. I don't know if you want to add anything there, Matt.
I think that's well covered. I think if one more thing is to suggest, we have been working in these markets for well over 20 years, and a lot of Canadian exporters have. We're not going to lose it overnight over a small amount of savings that they could see. And that, with that being said, we need to continue to be competitive, because otherwise we will lose it. But we're well positioned not to lose these markets and to continue to provide them with what they're looking for.
All right. Well, on that note, I guess we will wrap up the first session from the London Farm Show Connect, sponsored by Ontario Mutuals. A big thank you to Sandy, Matt, and Patrick for taking the time out of your day this morning to chat with us. A great session to kick off the Farm Show Connect. So thank you very much. And a big thank you to New Farm for sponsoring this session. We do have some time before the next one, starting at 11:15, which is on Farm Gate Marketing. So go grab a coffee, take a break, and we'll see you back here shortly. Thank you.